بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد, today we begin the 24th sitting of Majlis الرابع والعشرون في أوصاف أهل الجنة in the describing or the description of the people of Jannah. جعلنا الله منهم بمنه وكرمه. So Allah make us from among those with His bounty and His kindness. So we begin, Bismillah, with the introduction. الحمد لله الذي كون الأشياء وأحكمها خلقا وفتق السماوات والأرض وكانتا رتقا وقسم بحكمته العباد فأسعد وأشقى وجعل للسعادة أسبابا فسلكها من كان أتقى فنظر بعين البصيرة إلى الأواقب فاختار ما كان أبقى أحمده وما أقضي له بالحمد حقا وأشكره ولم يزل لشكري مستحقا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له مالك الرقاب كله رقة وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أكمل البشر خلقا وخلقا صلى الله عليه وعلى صاحبه أبي بكر الصديق الحائز بفضائل الأتباع سبقا وعلى أمر العادل فما يحاب ما يحابي حلقا وعلى عثمان الذي استسلم للشهادة وما توقع وعلى علي بائع ما يفنى ومشتري ما يبقى وعلى آله وأصحابه الناصرين لدين الله حقا وسلم تسليما. So the Sheikh, he says in this introduction, all praise belongs to Allah, the one who made everything with perfection. He divided the heavens and the earth, although they were once a united piece. With his wisdom, he separated the slaves. Some of them he made successful and others wretched. He placed the means for success, so the pious ones have taken the means and looked at the consequences with insight. As a result, they chose that which is more lasting over that which perishes, meaning Jannah hereafter, rather than the worldly life. I praise him even though I do not give him his right due of praise. And I thank him although his worthiness of being thanked is ageless. And I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped in truth but him alone without a partner. He is the owner of all that exists. I also bear witness that Muhammad is his slave, a messenger, the most complete of mankind in his nature and manners. May Allah's blessings be upon him, his companion Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, the one who grasped the virtue of precedence in fellowship, upon Umar, the just, who has never taken sides with any creature, upon Uthman, the one who submitted to martyrdom and did not try to avoid it, and upon Ali, the one who sold what perishes, i.e. the dunya, worldly life, and purchase what remains forever, meaning the paradise and that which is with Allah, and upon the Prophet's family and his companions, the true helpers of the religion. So then the Shaykh, he begins and he says, Ikhwani, my brothers, سمعتم أوصاف الجنة ونعيم ونعيمها وما فيها من السرور والفرح والحبور. فوالله إنها لجديرة بأن يعمل لها العاملون ويتنافس فيها المتنافسون ويفني الإنسان عمره في طلبها زاحدا في الدون فإن سألتم عن العمل لها والطريق الموصول إليها فقد بينه الله فيما أنزله من وحيه على أشرف رسله قال الله عز وجل وسارعوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة أرضها السماوات والأرض أعدت للمتقين الذين ينفقون في السراء والضراء والكاظمين الغيظ والعافين عن الناس والله يحب المحسنين والذين إذا فعلوا فاحشة أو ظلموا أنفسهم ذكروا الله فاستغفروا لذنوبهم ومن يغفر الذنوب إلا الله ولم يصروا على ما فعلوا وهم يعلمون. So that is Surah Imran, verse 133 to 135. So the Sheikh here mentions, my dear brothers, you have heard the descriptions of paradise and its bliss. And that was mentioned by our brother Shaib in the previous lesson. And what is in it of, happiness and jubilation and fun. But Allah, this paradise is worthy of being striven for, worked hard for and competed for. It is precious enough for a man to spend all his life seeking it while renouncing this inferior, lowly world. And if you asked about the deeds one must do in order to obtain this paradise or the path to take in order to reach it, then Allah has indeed clarified this when He revealed, in the following ayat in Surah Imran, when He says, "And hasten to forgiveness from your Lord and a garden as wide as the heavens and the earth prepared for the pious who spend in the cause of Allah during ease and hardship and who restrain anger and who pardon the people. And Allah loves the doers of good and those who, when they commit an immoral action or wrong themselves by transgression, remember Allah and seek forgiveness for the sins. And who can forgive sins except Allah? And who do not persist in what they have done while they know." And that is Surah Al-Imran. So now the Sheikh is going to break down these categories, from this ayah. So فَهَذِهِ إِدَّةُ أَوْسَافٍ مِنْ أَوْسَافِ أَهْلَ الْجَنَّةِ. So these are a number of the characteristics of the people of Jannah, the people of Paradise. So وَصْفَ الْأَوَّلِ المتقين. So then he says the first description is what? That they are the pious. المتقين. وهم الذين اتقوا ربهم باتخاذ الوقاية من عذابه بفعل ما أمرهم به طاعة له ورجاء لثوابه وترك ما نهاهم عن طاعة له وخوفا من عقابه. So the Sheikh mentions the first description is that they are pious. Meaning they are those who fear their Lord by placing a protection or barrier from his punishment. Yeah? Between them and his punishment. By adhering, so obeying his commands, while hoping for his reward and staying away from his prohibitions out of obedience to Allah and out of fear of his punishment. So that's the first description, being pious. Yeah. Putting that protection between yourself from his punishment by obeying the commands of Allah and being obedient to Allah, hoping for the reward and leaving and staying away from whatever Allah prohibited from in obedience to him and fearing from the punishment. Then the Sheikh, he says, al-wasf al-thani, the second description, he said, الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي صَرَّاءِ وَضَرَّاءِ. So same, extracting from the ayah, those who, he mentioned, those who spend at times of ease and at times of hardship. So, فَهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ مَا أُمِرُوا بِإِنْفَاقِهِ عَلَى الْوَجْهِ الْمَطْلُوبِ مِنْهُمْ مِنَ الزَّكَاةِ وَالصَّدَقَاتِ وَالنَّفَقَاتِ عَلَى مَنْ لَهُ حَقٌّ عَلَيْهِمْ والنفقات في الجهاد وغيره من سبل الخير ينفقون ذلك في سراء وضراء لا تحملهم سراء والرخاء على حب المال وشح في طمعا في زيادته ولا تحملهم الشدة والضراء على إمساك المال خوف من الحاجة إليه. So here the Sheikh mentions that those who spend at times of ease and of hardship in the path of Allah. So they spending what? So the Sheikh clarifies, he said they spend whatever they are commanded to spend in. So that is, and is required for them to spend in. So it includes the obligatory charity, the zakat that they're supposed to give to the poor, yeah, and spending on whoever they are financially responsible for, your family members, that, you know, your children, your wives, and other than that, your parents. Likewise, they spend in the path of Allah in jihad, you know, paying for if there's a jihad going on, war, in the path of good. Yeah, they spend at times of ease and hardship, yeah, and comfort and in happiness. So comfort and happiness does not lead them to greed and selfishness, so that where they withhold from spending in the path of Allah. Likewise, difficulty and hardship does not cause them to become stingy, so due to fear of poverty. So they don't fear that. They have that reliance on Allah, and they spend in the cause of Allah. Whether it's obligatory charity or is what optional sadaqah, and they spend on the family members as well. That comes under that as well. So that is the people from the description of the people of paradise. So there's some people who will spend in zakat because they know it's obligatory, but yet on their own family members, the needs of the family members are not met. So we need to be careful that we are meeting the needs of our children and family members from food, from clothing, from education. And when we mean education, we don't mean the dunya education. We mean the Islamic education. We find so many people, they'll have a master's. They'll have, their A-levels in maths and science and the degree, and they'll have master's and PhDs. But yeah, their parents didn't spend in reading for the children to read the Quran, to know the correct aqidah, you know, to know what is right and wrong. You know, Islamically, they don't know who the Prophet ﷺ is, who is Allah. So this is, you know, something that we need to do. We need to give that preference, not just the worldly knowledge. So then the Sheikh, he said, the third characteristic is what? وَالْكَاذِمِينَ الْغَيْذِ. So they are the what? Those who suppress the anger. So me, they control the anger. So وَهُمُ الْحَابِسُونَ لِغَدَبِهِمْ إِذَا غَدِبُوا أَلَا فَلَا يَعْتَدُونَ وَلَا يَحْقِدُونَ أَلَى غَيْرِهِمْ بِسَبَبِهِ. So those who are control and suppress the anger when they get angered. Yeah. So when they become angry, they can control the anger. And it comes to a reminding of another hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, a strong person is not one who can out-wrestle this one or that one, but a strong one is one who can control his anger when he becomes angry. That is a strong person. So so those who control their anger when they are enraged, as a result, they do not envy or hate others due to this anger of theirs. Okay, so that's the third category. Then we go on to the fourth category, which is al-wasf al-rabi wal-afina anil-nas. يعفون عمن ظلمهم واعتدى عليهم فلا ينتقمون لأنفسهم مع قدرتهم على ذلك وفي قوله تعالى والله يحب المحسنين إشارة إلى أن العفو لا يمدح إلا إذا كان من الإحسان وذلك بأن يقع موقعه ويكون إصلاحا فأما العفو الذي تزداد به جريمة المعتدي فليس بمحمود ولا مأجور عليه. قال الله تعالى فمن عفا وأصلح فأجره على الله. So Shura was 40. So here we're just going to translate that. The Sheikh, he mentions the fourth characteristic of the people of the paradise is that those who forgive the people. So now the Sheikh is going to mention what is the praiseworthy forgiveness and what is the forgiveness that is not praiseworthy and that you shouldn't do. So the person, he forgives the one who's oppressed him, yeah, and who's either attacked him, or and he seek revenge for himself. Yeah, even though he's able to do that, he doesn't seek revenge for himself. And that is according to the speech of Allah, where Allah says, He said, Allah, Allahu yuhibbul muhsinin. So Allah loves those who are kind. Yeah? And this is an indication to the one who forgives and be considered praiseworthy if it results in something positive. If it results in al-ihsan, which is a positive outcome. So for example, someone oppressed you, you forgive them, and a reconciliation, for example. Yeah, one of those. Yeah. But the forgiveness that increases in the transgressor or transgression, it will not be considered praiseworthy. And the individual will not be rewarded for it. For indeed Allah said, whoever forgive and reform, then his reward is with Allah. So, for example, someone oppresses you and you forgive them and they're going to oppress you again, that is not from the praiseworthy forgiveness. Yeah. So that is not something that should be done. So you should only forgive where they begins where it brings about rectification and benefit. Yeah. So then the next trait is al-wasl al-khamis, the fifth one, is وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ الْفَاحِشَةُ مَا يُسْتَفْحَشُ مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ وَهِيَ الْكَبَائِرُ كَقَتْلِ النَّفْسِ الْمُحَرَّمَةِ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ وَأَقُوقِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَأَكْلِ الرِّبَا وَأَكْلِ الْمَالِ الْيَتِيمِ وَالتَّوَلِّي يوم الزحف والزنا والسرقة ونحوها من الكبائر وأما الظلم وأظم الظلم النفس فهو أعم فيشمل الصغائر والكبائر فهم إذا فعلوا شيئا من ذلك ذكروا أظمة من أسوه فخافوا منه وذكروا مغفرته ورحمته فسعوا في أسباب ذلك فاستغفروا لذنوبهم بطلب سترها والتجاوز عن العقوبة عليها وفي قوله ومن يغفر الذنوب إلا الله إشارة إلى أنهم لا يطلبون المغفرة من غير الله لأنه لا يغفر الذنوب سواه. So here the Sheikh, he mentions in the fifth category is are those who, when they commit a fahisha, a sin, or immorality or wrong themselves by transgression, they remember Allah and seek forgiveness for the sins. So when the person commits sins, he seeks forgiveness for his sins. So that is the fifth characteristic of a person when people of paradise. So the word al-fahisha refers to sins that are considered to be atrocities and immorality. So these are major sins. So examples of these sins include, like for example, murdering someone. Yeah. That you have no right in killing, being undutiful to your parents. Yeah, so being undutiful to your parents and consuming interest, riba. How many people consider interest nowadays? Allah protect us from that and Allah guide them. Ameen. Yeah, and so look at the major sins: murder, being disobedient, and being undutiful to your parents. And consuming interest. So these are all major sins. And consuming the wealth of the orphans. Yeah. And running away from the battlefield. Yeah. And fornication. Yeah. How many people fall into that nowadays as well? Robbery. And their likes are from the major sins. Yeah. So these are all the major sins. We need to seek forgiveness from Allah. There is forgiveness. We need to seek forgiveness from Allah and stay away and not return to those actions. Wronging oneself is more general. So if someone oppressed himself, it's more general. So it can be included in both the major sins or the minor sins. So whenever the believer commits any of the above mentioned sins, they remember the greatness of the one who they disobeyed, Allah. As a result, they will be afraid of him, leading them to remember his forgiveness and mercy. Yeah. And they also remember his punishment as well. So they don't rely on Allah's mercy only. So they see they are rushed to seek forgiveness from Allah. They ask forgiveness of their sins by asking Allah to cover their sins and to overlook them and not punish them for it. Yeah. So Allah said in the statement, none forgives sins but Allah. So this indicates that the believers do not seek forgiveness from anyone but Allah, because none forgives sins except Him. So that was the fifth category. So when they commit sins, they seek forgiveness from Allah. As al-wasf al-sadis wa lam yusirru ala ma fa'alu wa hum ya'lamun. Ay lam yastamirru ala fi'l al-dhanbi wa hum ya'lamun annahu dhanb wa ya'lamun azmata man asawhu wa ya'lamun qurba maghfiratihi bal يبادرون إلى الإقلاء عنه والتوبة منه فالإصرار على الذنوب مع هذا العلم يجعل الصغائر كبائر ويتدرج بالفاعل إلى أمور الخطيرة صعبة وقال تعالى قد أفلح المؤمنون الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون والذين هم عن اللغو معرضون والذين هم لزكاة فاعلون والذين هم لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون والذين هم لأماناتهم وأحدهم راعون والذين هم على صلواتهم يحافظون أولئك هم الوارثون الذين يرثون الفردوس هم فيها خالدون فهذه الآيات الكريمة جمعت عدة أوصاف من أوصاف أهل الجنة. So we'll continue with that inshallah after we translate this. So the sixth characteristic of the description of the people of paradise is when it says they do not persist in their sins and they acknowledge that it is a sin. Yeah. So it meaning that they don't continue upon committing a sin and they know that it is a sin. So if they know that it's a sin, for example, someone falls into a sin of, stealing. So he's fallen into it. The first time is difficult for him. Well, he's done it and he's got used to it. Now, if he seeks forgiveness from Allah, he knows it's wrong. But if he persists on that's wrong. He shouldn't be doing that. So when he knows that it's a sin, he seeks forgiveness from Allah and he doesn't persist on it. Yeah, and he knows that the greatness of the one who is disobeying. And he knows how close he is to be forgiven, but rather he hurries to make forgiveness. Yeah? So he hastens to free himself from the sin and he repents from them. This is because persisting upon committing sins with the knowledge that it's a sin turns the minor sin into a major sin. So it might be a minor sin before, but it becomes a major sin. And it leads the sinner to difficult and dangerous situations. Yeah. So, and Allah said, read the translation of this ayah. So the translation of this ayah of Surah Mu'minun, verse 1 to 11 is, successful indeed are the believers who are humble in their prayers and who shun all that which is vain, and who are prompt and regular in paying the zakat, and who guard their chastity, except from their wives and what their right hands possess. For them they are not to be blamed, but those who seek anything beyond that are transgressors. Yeah. Successful are the believers who are watchful over their trust and their covenants, meaning their contracts and agreements, and those who are strict in the observance of their prayers, and these are the hearers who who will inherit paradise. They will abide therein forever. So that was a proof that to not persist upon sin. Then the Sheikh mentioned the noble verses gathered many qualities of the people of paradise. So then the Sheikh mentions al-wasf al-awwal, the first quality of the people of paradise, al-mu'minun. So now we're mentioning in this ayah that they are the believers. Yeah, so they are believers. So al-ladina amnu billahi wa bi kulli ma yajibu al-imanu bihi min al-malaikati Allahi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawm al-akhiri wal qadri khayrihi wa sharrihi amnu bidhalika imanan yastalzimu al-qabul wal-idhan wal-inqiyad bil-qawli wal-amal. So the Sheikh, he said the first characteristic from these verses of the people of paradise is that they are those who believe in Allah and the things that are necessary or required to believe in, such as the angels of Allah, his books, the books of Allah, you know, the Quran and what came before it, his messengers, all of them, prophets and messengers, the day of judgment and what is connected with that, and pre-decree, the good and the bad of that. And they believe in that in a firm belief that necessitates acceptance and submission with statements and action. Yeah. So that is the first characteristic. Then the second characteristic, al-wasf al-thani, alladhina hum fi salatihim khashi'un, hadiratun qulubuhum sakinatun jawarihum yastahdiruna annahum qa'imuna fi salatihim bayna yaday Allah azza wa jal yukhatibunahu bi kalamihi wa yatakarrabuna ilayhi bi dhikrihi wa yalja'una wa ilayhi بدعائه فهم خاشعون بظواهرهم وبواتنهم. So the second characteristic, the quality is, or characteristic of the one person of Jannah is, those are humble in their prayers. They have that khushu, they are humble in their prayers. Yeah. So they have that attention, you know, that focus. They have that tranquility. And their hearts are, you know, aware. And their limbs are tranquil. They recall that they are standing in front of their Lord, addressing Him in their prayer with their speech and actions, and they say, with the speech and seeking closeness to Him with His remembrance. And they rely on Him with the dua. They are humble to Him inwardly and outwardly. So that is being humble in your prayer, inwardly and outwardly. And remembering that you're addressing, you're having that conversation with Allah, that prayer, that supplication. Then the third characteristic is al-waswa al-thalis, wal-ladhina hum anil-lagwi mu'ridun, wal-lagwu kullu ma la fa'idatum fihi, wa la khayra min qawlin aw fi'l. فهم معرضون عنه لقوة أزمة عزيمتهم وشدة حزمهم لا يمدون أوقاتهم الثمينة إلا فيما فيه فائدة فكما حفظوا صلاتهم بالخشوع حفظوا أوقاتهم عن الدياء وإذا كان من وصفهم الإعراض عن اللغو وهو ما لا فائدة فيه فإرادها وإرادهما أما فيه مضرة من باب أولى. So the Sheikh then he mentions that the third quality is that those who shun lagu, that which is vain, everything that is vain. So the lagu here refers to anything that is devoid of good. So anything void of good. So anything that is does not have no benefit in it, yeah, good or benefit, whether it's a statement or action. So the believers are those who are turned away from it because of their strong determination. They only spend their precious time engaged in that which will bring benefit to them. Just as they preserve their prayers with the khushu, with the tranquility, they also preserve their time from being wasted. And if turning away from something that is vain is part of the quality of of the one who enters Jannah than it is more deserving of them to turn away from things that are harmful to them. So turning away from things that do not benefit you, there's no benefit in time. So that is another characteristic of the believer. Then the fourth, al-wasfu rabi, wal-ladhina hum li-zakati fa'ilun. So the fourth characteristics is the one who gives zakat. So those who pay the zakat. يحتمل أن المراد بالزكاة القسط الواجب دفعه من المال الواجب زكاته ويحتمل أن المراد بها كل ما تزكو به نفوسها من قول أو عمل. So then here the Sheikh mentions that the intent by zakat here is the term zakat could mean the percentage from your money that must be paid to the poor, with 2.5% from your monetary wealth, or it could carry the general meaning, which is every statement or action that purifies the soul. So it means purifying the soul as well. So both of them meanings can be understood from that. To purify your wealth and purify your soul from with righteous actions and speech. So then the fifth quality, al-wasf al-khamisu, wal-ladhina hum لفروجهم حافظون إلا على أزواجهم أو ما ملكت أيمانهم فإنهم غير ملومين. So the Sheikh mentions the Quran ayat, those who preserve their chastity, yeah, except from their wives or that which their right hand possess, they are not to be blamed. So these meaning that you do not fall into looking at anything that is forbidden. You only enjoy in the halal way with your wife and with whatever your right hand possesses. For example, in the time of the Muslims when they had slaves, the slave as well, a woman. Yeah. So it means that not going into haram relationships, boyfriend, girlfriend, not committing zina and with a zina of the eyes, or tongue or texting and conversing with a woman that you're not supposed to be. So this all comes under that. فَهُمْ حَافِذُونَ لِفُرُوجِهِمْ عَنِ الزِّنَا وَالْلِوَاتِ لِمَا فِيهِمَا مِنْ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ وَالْإِنْحِطَاطِ الْخُلُقِي وَالْإِجْتِمَاعِ وَلَعَلَّ حَفِظَ الْفَرْجِ وَلَعَلَّ حِفْظَ الْفَرْجِ يَشْمَلُ مَا هُوَ أَعَمُّ مِنْ ذَلِكَ فَيَشْمَلُ حِفْظَهُ عن النظر واللمس أيضا وفي قوله فإنهم غير ملومين إشارة إلى أن الأصل لوم الإنسان على هذا الفعل إلا على الزوجة والمملوكة لما في ذلك من الحاجة إليه لدفع مقتضى الطبيعية وتحصيل النسل وغيره من المصالح وفي عموم قوله فمن ابتغى وراء ذلك فأولئك هم العادون دليل على تحريم الاستمناء الذي يسمى العادة السرية لأنه عملية في غير الزوجات والمملوكات. طيب, so that the Sheikh he mentions now in regarding to this characteristic, the fifth one, that the person who preserves their chastity, yeah, so they don't from fornication and homosexuality. So alhamdulillah, subhanallah, the Sheikh even mentioned that is that's rife at the moment, homosexuality that is being pushed by the LGP, whatever the characteristics are, and the Muslims are falling into that, defending them, aiding them, and falling into that as well. So Allah protect us and the Muslims and all the other people from that, and guide the people to the haqq. Ameen. So this is another thing, when people need to protect themselves from falling into this and protect by looking at whatever's forbidden, because this the person falls into a sin. Yeah. So here, Sheikh, he says, because these acts are disobedience to Allah and they deteriorate the society. And you see that with the all the open zina and all the other LGBT whatever nasty stuff that's going on, and inferiority in character, So it is a despicable character. And even more general than the obligation of preserving oneself from touching and looking at that which is not permissible to touch and look at. As for the aforementioned, they are not to be blamed. This is an indication, the ayah, they are not to be blamed. This is an indication that the origin of this act is blameworthy. So the people who preserve, you know, by having relations with their wives and whoever they own from slaves, if it's time when the Muslims own slaves, female slaves, they are not to be blamed, showing that other than that is blameworthy. So if it's done with other than the wife or with the whatever the right hand possesses, from because of the need that is in order to fulfill the natural need that a man has or a woman has, for the making of you know offspring and other benefits, that they are blameworthy. So the also the generality of the statement, but those who ask anything beyond that are the transgressors, is a proof for the impermissibility of people masturbating. So some people now say, oh no, masturbation is okay. No, it isn't. It shows that impermissibility of masturbation, also known as the secret habit. Yeah, that is because masturbation is ejaculation, but not by way of the legal way, which is by way of your spouse, or the permissible way of the what your right hand possesses. So if it's not by one of the slaves that a man possesses or by his spouse, then it's impermissible. And likewise for a woman as well. If it's not with her husband, then it's impermissible. So then the sixth characteristic is al-wasf al-sadis wal-ladhina hum li amanatihim wa ahdihim ra'un. So then the sixth quality is, and those who are watchful over their trust and their covenants, meaning their contracts and their trust, they're trustworthy. So al-amanatu ma yu'tamanu alayhi min qawli aw fi'l aw ayni faman hadathaka bisirrin faqad i'tamanaka wa man fa'ala indaka la yuhibbu al-itla'a alayhi faqad i'tamanaka ومن سلمك شيئا من ماله لحفظه فقد ائتمنك والأحد ما وما يلتزم به الإنسان لغيره كالنذر لله والعهود الجارية بين الناس فأهل الجنة قائمون برعاية الأمانات والأحد fima bainahum wa bain Allah wa fima bainahum wa bain al khalq wa yadkhulu fi dhalika al wafa'u bil uqud wa shurut al mabahati fiha. So here this is very important, and this is something that many of the Muslims in this day this day of ours are sadly lacking, and that is trust. And the trust includes statements and actions and items as well. Therefore, so someone, if he's informed, if someone tells you a secret, you do not expose that secret. That's a trust with you. He has that. He's entrusted you with that. So whoever does an action in your presence but does not want it to be exposed has entrusted you. Yeah. And if someone gave you his wealth to preserve it, he has entrusted you. Yeah. So you need to give it back. But a covenant, an oath, is whatever the individual imposes on himself to do for someone else. An example of that is to make a vow to Allah to do a particular deed, or even the promise which took place between the people. So the people of paradise are those who fulfill their trust and keep their promises with Allah and with the people. So this also includes fulfilling the contracts and the lawful conditions between the people. So this is something that we need to be careful about and mindful. So either an oath that is between you and Allah, you need to fulfill it. Otherwise, pay the recompense, which is fasting a certain amount of time. You need to find out about that if you can't keep that oath that you made for between you and Allah. But for other than that, whether it's something someone's left in your possession, look after this for me, please. Look after my house, look after my property. You need to do that. You need to fulfill that. Someone left some money with you. You need to give that money back. Yeah, someone has told you a secret. Keep that secret. Don't be spreading about. So this is very important that we are trustworthy. Muslims are trustworthy. And then that's the sixth category. The seventh one, the quality is al-wasl sabit wal-ladina hum ala salawatihim yuhafidun. So the seventh quality is those who establish the prayers and they preserve the prayers. Yeah, so they are preserving the prayers. They're not neglectful of the prayers. Yulazimuna ala hifdhiha min al-ida'ati wal-tafrit wadhalika bi-ada'iha fi waqtiha ala wajhi الأكمل بشروطها وأركانها وواجباتها وقد ذكر الله سبحانه وتعالى أوصافا كثيرة في القرآن لأهل الجنة سواء ما نقلناه هنا ذكر ذلك سبحانه ليتصف به من أراد الوصول إليها وفي الأحاديث عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من ذلك شيء كثير. So then the Sheikh, he mentions the second the seventh category or the quality of the people is those who establish the prayers. They are consistent in preserving the prayers and no negligence of them. So they carry out them in the complete manner, fulfilling them in the conditions, pillars, and obligations on the right time. Yeah, and Allah mentioned in the Quran many qualities of the people of paradise. Besides what we have mentioned here, Allah the Glorified mentioned these qualities so that those who want to enter paradise will, be those who have those qualities, and strive to attain these kind of qualities and characteristics. Likewise, many of those qualities are mentioned in a number of hadith mentioned by the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So then we go on to mention that. So فمن أبي فمن فأن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سحل الله له به طريقا إلى الجنة رواه مسلم. And from that is a hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم from Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه, may Allah be pleased with him, who mentioned that whoever treads on a path in which he seeks knowledge, Allah will ease for him a path to paradise, Jannah. And that's collected by Muslim. Yeah. So that's a Sahih hadith. So seeking knowledge of this religion, it'll make that path easy to Jannah. وَلَهُ عَنْهُ أَيْذًا أَنَ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ قَالَ أَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى مَا يَمْحُ اللَّهُ بِهِ الْخَطَايَا ويرفع به الدرجات قالوا بلى يا رسول الله قال إسباغ الوضوء على مكاره وكثرة الخطى إلى المساجد وانتظار الصلاة بعد الصلاة. So then the Sheikh mentions another hadith mentioned by Abu Huraira again. May Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, shall I not guide you to what Allah expiates the sins with and elevates the ranks of the person? They said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. He said, performing the ablution in a perfect manner, meaning performing the wudu in a perfect manner at times of hardship and taking many steps to the masjid, meaning if you live in a distant part of a far from the masjid, taking them steps to the masjid will be rewarded, and waiting for the next prayer after the previous prayer. So if you stay in the prayer, pray complete one prayer and you wait for the other prayer, there's a lot of reward on that. And that's also collected by Muslim, Sahih. So then he said, وَلَهُ عَنْ عُمَرَ بِنْ خَطَّابَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ يَتَوَدَّأُ فيصبغ الوضوء ثم يقول أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله إلا فتحت له أبواب الجنة الثمانية يدخل من أيها شاء. So it's mentioned from Umar bin Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, the Prophet said that none of you will perform wudu in a perfect manner, and then says, I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah alone without a partner, and I testify that Muhammad is his slave and messenger, except that the 8 doors of paradise will be opened for him, and he'll be able to enter from whichever door he wants. And that's again a Sahih Hadith from Sahih Muslim. So we should be on the habit of making this supplication. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika la, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh, after making wudu. Yeah, to be from those who qualify. And you mentioned wa an Umar bin Khattab radiallahu anhu aidan fi man في من تابع المؤذن المؤذنة من قلبه دخل الجنة. So then he mentioned also narrated by Umar رضي الله عنه. He said whoever repeats the call to prayer in his heart will enter paradise. So when you repeat the prayer, the adhan, as with the muadhin, you will enter paradise. And that's collected by Muslim as well. And then Uthman, then another hadith, we go on to here. See, well, and Uthman bin Affan radiallahu anhu, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam khala, man bana masjidan yabtaghi bihi wajh Allah bana Allah lahu baytan fi al-jannah, muttafaqun alayh. So Uthman bin Affan, one of the Khulafa Rashidin, may Allah be pleased with him, said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever built a masjid and seeking for it the face of Allah, desiring the pleasure of Allah on the face of Allah, Allah will build for him a house in Jannah. And that's agreement by Bukhari and Muslim. So whoever builds a masjid as well. So عن عبادة بن صامت رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال خمس صلوات كتبهن الله على العباد فمن جاء بهن ولم يضيع منهن شيئا استخفافا بحقهن كان له عند الله أحدا أن يدخله الجنة. رواه الإمام أحمد وأبو داود والنسائي. So here then said he mentioned from mentioned by Ubadah bin Samit, may Allah be pleased with him, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said there are 5 daily prayers that Allah prescribed on the slaves. Whoever established them without being neglectful of them and belittling their obligations, so whoever fulfills all those will have with his Lord the promise to submit him into paradise. That's collected by Imam Ahmad, Abu Dawood, and Nisa'i. And some of his chains and of narration are strengthened by others. And Al-Albani, Sheikh Albani, graded it as authentic in his Sahih Abu Dawood. So it's authentic, the chain. So then we go on to وعن ثوبان رضي الله عنه أنه سأل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن عمل يدخله you know, يدخله الله به الجنة فقال عليك بكثرة السجود وإنك لا تسجد لله سجدة إلا رفعك الله بها درجة وحتى عندك وحتى أنك بها خطيئة. رواه مسلم. And that's also mentioned by Thoban that he asked the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam about a deed by which Allah will admit him into paradise. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you must perform a lot of prostrations, because whenever you prostrate to Allah, he will elevate your rank with it and expiate a sin. That's Sahih Muslim. Yeah, that's a hadith in Sahih Muslim, to making a lot of sujoods. So that is another way for you to enter Jannah. And then وعن أم حبيبة رضي الله عنها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما من عبد مسلم يصلي لله تعالى في كل يوم 12 ركعة تطوعا غير فريضة إلا بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة. رواه مسلم. وهن 4 قبل الظهر وركعتان بعد المغرب وركعتان بعد العشاء وركعتان قبل صلاة Subhi. So here then he mentions a hadith by Habiba, the mother of believers, may Allah be pleased, Hafsa, the daughter of Umar and the wife of the Prophet, may Allah be pleased with that, that the Messenger said, whoever from the slaves, from the Muslims, prays the 12 supererogatory prayers, the optional prayers, the sunnahs, except that, so whoever prays the 12 voluntary prayers for Allah, and they are not the compulsory prayers, except that Allah will build for him a house in Jannah, and that's collected by Muslim. And the 12 units of prayer, the sunnahs are what? Are the four sunnahs before the fard of dhuhr. So the four sunnahs before the fard of dhuhr, the two sunnahs after it. So there's what? In Zohar we got what? 4 plus 2, that's 6. Yeah. Then we got two sunnahs after Maghrib, so that's 8. And there's two after Isha, that's 10. And there's two sunnahs before the Fajr prayer, so that's 12. So if someone is consistent with those, then Allah will build a house for them in Jannah, and they will enter Jannah. And then another hadith, وَأَنْ مُعَاذِ بْنِ جَبَلَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَّهُ قَالَ لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أخبرني بعمل يدخلني الجنة ويباعدني عن النار قال لقد سألت عن عظيم وإنه لا يصير على من يسره الله عليه تعبد الله ولا تشرك به شيئا وتقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة وتصوم رمضان وتحج البيت وتحج البيت الحديث ورواه أحمد والترمذي وصححه عن أن سحل بن سعد رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إن في الجنة بابا يقال له الريان يدخل منه الصائمون يوم القيامة لا يدخل منه أحدا غيرهم الحديث متفق عليه. And I'm just going to quickly read through the rest of this. وعن أبي حريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الأمرة إلى أمرة كفارة لما بينهما والحج المبرور ليس له جزاء إلا الجنة متفق عليه. وعن جابر رضي الله عنه قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من كان له ثلاث بنات يؤويهن ويرحمهن ويكفلهن وجبت له الجنة البتة. قيل يا رسول الله فإن كانتا اثنتين قال وإن كانتا اثنتين. وقال فرأى بعض القوم أن لو قال واحدة لقال واحدة رواه أحمد. وعن أبي حريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سئل عن أكثر ما يدخل الجنة فقال تقوى الله وحسن الخلق رواه الترمذي وابن حبان. وفي صحيحه عن إياد بن همار المجاشئي أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أهل الجنة ثلاثة ذو سلطان مقسط متصدق موفق ورجل رحيم رقيق القلب لكل ذي قربى ومسلم وعفيف متعفف ذو عيال رواه مسلم في حديث طويل. So we're just going to translate those last few hadith that we said. So we mentioned from Muad bin Jabal that he mentioned that he asked the Prophet inform me about a deed that will allow me to enter paradise and distant me from the hellfire. So Prophet said to him, you have indeed asked about a great matter, but it is easy for whoever Allah makes it easy. Worship Allah and do not associate partners with him, so do not commit shirk with him. Establish the prayer, pay the zakat, fast the month of Ramadan, and perform the pilgrimage to the sacred house of Allah. So all the five pillars collected by Imam Ahmad and Tirmidhi, and Albani greatly authentic in Sahih al-Tirmidhi. So then the Sheikh he mentioned after that, it was mentioned another hadith of on Sahal bin Sa'ad. So Sahal bin Sa'd, he said that the Messenger said, indeed, indeed in paradise there is a door called Ar-Rayyan. Only those who fast will enter it. No one else beside them will enter it. And that's Bukhari Muslim, so it's authentic hadith. So Allah make us from those who enter that door. Because we are in this month of fasting, and Allah said from us our fasting. So Bab Ar-Rayyan. And then you mentioned from Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu that the Prophet said that here he mentioned he mentioned about Abu Huraira that you know the Umrah to a Umrah is expiation of what is between of the sins, and Hajj that a Hajj accepted there is nothing except for Hajj that is accepted, there's no reward for it except Jannah. So a Hajj that is accepted, there's nothing for it in reward except for Jannah. And that is Bukhari Muslim that is mentioned. And then he mentions in another hadith from Jabir, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet said, whoever has three daughters and he takes good care of them and shows mercy to them and nurtures them, then paradise will be obligatory for him. It was said, O Messenger of Allah, what if there are only two daughters? He said, even if there are only two. And then the narrator, he said, some of them thought if they were to ask the Prophet about one daughter, he would say yes. So Imam Ahmad narrated this hadith, and his chain of narrations are weak. However, there are other authentic narrations that support this narration. From among them, narrations in the statement of the Prophet whoever is treated with having attested with having daughters but took good care of them, they will be a whale for him against the hellfire. And that's collected by his Muslim, so it's Sahih. And it's also narrated by Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him. That the Prophet was asked about the most common thing that will lead an individual to paradise, and he said, he said the fear of Allah and good character. So it's collected by Tirmidhi and Ibn Hibban and Al-Arnud grade 8 to be sound. And it's also narrated by Iyad bin Al-Himar Al-Mujashi that the Prophet said the people of paradise are three: a just ruler who is generous and successful, a man who is merciful and soft-hearted to every kin, meaning those who are related to him, and every content Muslim who has a large family but adopts abstinence. Yeah. So and it's collected by a Muslim. So then the Sheikh mentions, فَهَذَا يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِخْوَانِ طائفة من أحاديث النبي تبين شيئا كثيرا من أعمال أهل الجنة لمن أراد الوصول إليها. أسأل الله أن ييسر لنا ولكم سلوكها ويثبتنا عليها، إنه جواد كريم. وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى وآله وصحبه أجمعين. So then the Sheikh mentions, he says, I ask Allah to make the path to paradise easy for us and you, and I ask Allah to keep us firm upon this path, and He is the most merciful, the most kind. I mean, the peace and blessings of Allah be upon His Prophet and His family and His companions, all of them. And with that, we finish. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu alayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.